Hey, so welcome aboard. We have today Osiris Garcia, also known as OC. We have Master's of Business Administration, is a local business person, and is an electrical engineer?
Electrical engineer, yeah.
And a University of Michigan graduate. Big Wolverines fan, right?
That's right. Go Blue.
So there was some people that asked me about the legal implications of the Michigan basketball team coach punching a coach of the Wisconsin team. Juwan Howard punches the coach of the Wisconsin team after the game. You saw that, right?
I did see that. It's not a very good look for the university. I do want to clarify. It was more of a smack, open hand. Not a, you know, open hand. It's just way too close to, you know, Detroit and the malice of the palace. And it's just a black eye for the sport. Just hoping that doesn't happen again.
Well, you know, I'm a UCLA graduate, and one of our basketball players, there was some sort of dispute after the game, and there was an allegation that the UCLA basketball player spit on this fan, and then at the University of Arizona, and the freaking Tucson police arrested him.
Wow.
Cited him for, you know, like assault and battery or something like that. And they didn't take him to the station. They cited him and arrested him on the spot and then released him on the spot. And then I was wondering, well, what the heck? Are they going to do that with Juwan Howard?
No arrest there. What happened to this UCLA player? Did he have to pay a fine?
No, I don't. Well, I don't know if the prosecutor is actually going to prosecute something like that. You know, in law, it's a very strange zone in the sports. There's all these cases where, you know, like a player will get punched by someone intentionally. And there's these like lawsuits where the batter, you know, the pitcher will intentionally throw that freaking ball at the guy, right?
That's right, they do that.
Yeah, so in everyday life, that is a major felony. That's an assault and battery. You know, you could really hurt someone. Then people have been hurt. So but when it happens in sports, there's this weird kind of gray area because people kind of consent to that in sports.
It's part of the game.
So that's why a lot of times when athletes will get in a fight or something, they won't get in legal trouble. You know what I'm saying? They might get like a penalty in the game.
I do want to point out that in hockey, it's all fair.
Right. What's the saying? I went to a fight and a hockey game broke out, right?
That's right.
But there was one guy. He did get both sued and in criminal trouble. This was like 20 years ago. He did something where he took the hockey stick and he just bashed the guy's head.
Oh, I think I remember that. Yes.
You know, it was like 20 years.
Now, that was a weapon.
Yeah. So that was so bad, even for hockey standards, that then he got, you know, he got sued. And I think there was an assault and battery charge with him too, if I recall correctly. Because even then, that would be way beyond the sport, you know? Yeah, I mean, we'll see. I don't think anything like that will happen with Juwan Howard. It was a friendly punch.
So far,
right?
It's a 5-game suspension. That's the rest of the regular season.
Yeah, it wasn't good. But at least from the legal standpoint, the good news for him is that he won't be in any legal trouble.
Well, so, if he needs a lawyer, I know where to send him.
Oh, okay. I'll help him out.
Yeah, tell him. Run it by Samo.
Run it by Joe Samo, exactly. So today, on the topic of sports, so the current event, the women's soccer team settled a very big federal case and are going to get $24 million.
Breaking news. Seems like they won that.
They won that one, right? And I wanted to go over that. And of course, what I like to do is that's a lot of money, $24 million. And this... The federation, okay, this is how it kind of started. The soccer, you know, about more than 100 years ago, okay, it was getting, you know, popular all around the world, uh-huh. All right? And it was during World War I, okay?
I love the history lessons that you bring over to us.
Okay, good. It was during World War I that then the United States Soccer Federation, in 1913, that's when the FIFA, right, the world organization started. And they said, we're going to try to get, you know, teams from different countries playing each other. And it was the next year, 1914, then the United States government then, you know, branched, you know, started. a federation called the United States Soccer Federation, right? And so they were their own entity back then, and it started in 1914 during World War One. Isn't that crazy? Wow. Like during the war, they're doing this soccer.
I see. I wonder if it's on the with the spirit of the Olympics. You know, the spirit of the Olympics is to try to battle it out on the sporting field instead of, you know,
instead of in the battlefield. Maybe that's why. Yeah, then during World War One, they're like, man, we gotta stop that. Instead of the trenches, we'll play soccer against each other. And the first international game for the United States was in 1916, also during World War One. It was in Norway. Which is crazy.
Who did they play? They played Norway and
Sweden. Which is okay. Can you imagine the, you know, one guy is going to war in World War One, you know, going off to war, and then this other guy is going off to play soccer, yeah, and we're both going to Europe, yeah, right? So I mean, this is how popular it is, right? And it's been growing obviously since then. Mm-hmm. And then a couple of the actual World Cup. So that is my favorite event. Every 4 years.
It's huge. I love it myself.
Yeah, and it's my favorite event, you know, is the World Cup. The first one was in 1930 in Uruguay.
Okay.
And Uruguay won.
Wow, okay. Yeah.
1930 was the first World Cup. So it's been around for a long time. It has been for a long time. And then obviously there's been these iconic and great soccer players, you know, like Pele, and my absolute favorite growing up, Diego Maradona,
Did you know I was in Brazil for a semester?
No, kidding.
Yeah, I had a good time down there. It was.
Did you go to any soccer games?
I went to several soccer games. I played with the locals. That was one of my goals. I had a to-do list while I was down there, and I got to play some soccer. I learned a lot.
What games did you go to? Like international games or their local?
No, the local games. I was in like Salvador area, and so mm-hmm. It's Victoria versus Bahia. That's the big rivalry there.
Right.
And so I went to that game.
Were you cheering for the correct team?
I went for the team that won.
You know, in England, they have laws and rules to try to keep these soccer hooligans in check.
That's right.
It's obviously a crazy sport. Not a crazy sport. The fans get crazy, I mean.
Uh-huh.
Right? So what year was that? Do you remember the year that you went?
Yeah, it was 2004, 2005.
Okay. So those games must have been huge then. To go to those games.
Yeah,
right?
it was big games. Like I said, it was the local, it's kind of saying the Jaguars versus the Dolphins, because they're not, you know, they're not the main strongest teams like Flamengo and Fluminense.
Oh, okay.
And it was still locally, that was the big game, the big team there, and that was a big rivalry too, those, because they're kind of sister cities.
So, I got you. Oh my God, that's pretty cool. Yeah. No, you know what? All these years, I never knew that you did that. Pele, he was, you know, obviously amazing during the 70s. And then he ended up, after he retired from international play, he played for a team in New York, in the North American Soccer League, NASL. Okay. That ended up folding.
Before the MLS.
Yeah, way before the MLS. It was called the New York Cosmos.
Okay.
And so they paid him a lot of money.
He might have got more money there than he did in Brazil.
Oh, heck yeah, he did. He got a lot of money. And then things changed a little bit. Finally, 1972, the federal government enacted the Title IX, right, that said anything that was getting federal funds or, you know, federally funded, and it has to have equal access, you know, for women and men.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so that was great. That at least got the ball rolling, right?
Yeah.
1972. It wasn't until 1985 that finally the women had a team. Okay, the international team. Yeah, 1985. So how many years? That's about 70 years after the men, right? So clearly, you know, they started off way later, obviously.
That's right.
Yeah. And the first time they played, it wasn't even a real team. What it was is there was some sort of tournament in Italy, and they invited the United States, and then the United States hired a coach, a male coach, okay? And he just picked a bunch of college women athletes.
Okay.
And then took them to Italy. So that was the first game.
I see.
It wasn't until 1985. By then, obviously, the men American team and the men World Cup teams were already super advanced.
I see.
Right? You know?
Now, what did they, since Title IX said you have equal opportunity since 1972, did they have something to counteract that for the men versus the women?
What do you mean?
Well, I think, I guess what I understand it is, for example, at the university level, the way they do Title IX is they have to have the same number of athletic teams for men versus women. And so, for example, at the University of Michigan, they had a women's soccer team to counteract that there's a women, I mean, men's football team.
Oh, right? Got it. Yes.
And so they couldn't get a men's soccer team going until they found another athletic team to bring in for women.
Yeah, that is absolutely correct. And same thing happened at UCLA. UCLA had a women's water polo team, as I recall, around the time I went there, but not like a men's team or something.
Okay, because of football.
Yeah, because football, right, you're right, they don't have women's football in college.
Yep.
So automatically there's one extra game, extra sport for men, and then they have to have like an equal balance.
Yeah.
Exactly, yeah. And my joke about that is a lot of lawyers have made a lot of money because there's always something, you know, it's like, oh, but the facilities aren't equal for the men's team and the women's team. And why are the men, you know, the scholarships have to be equal and then the sport, you know, so anytime something happens, you know, there's always a dispute. And nowadays, you know, there's a lot of talk, you know, people about the transgender, you know, like somebody playing on the women's team who was born a man or vice versa. There may be interesting litigation ultimately that happens from that.
great news for the lawyers.
Yeah, I guess you could say that. Yeah. I guess you could say that. You could say great news for the lawyers. Hopefully there'll be more inclusion. I personally think, you know, the law will gravitate toward, you know, if somebody declares that the gender, whatever gender they are, you know, that is what sport they could play. That's what I think will come down ultimately if, you know, after a lot of litigation. I don't think the courts will force somebody to play on the gender side that they don't identify with.
But you think it'd be fair to, if I say, hey, I identify as female, now I can try out for WNBA.
You know what? Okay, get this.
Don't get any thoughts.
No.
No ideas.
I know. When I was in law school,
All
right, it was 1998, okay? And I kind of made like a similar, but I was kind of joking, and I told a bunch of guys who were good at basketball, I'm like, let's just try out for the women's team. I just want to see them say no to us because we're men, you know. Let's just see what happens.
So you can sue them.
Yeah, so we could sue them maybe, right? And then we could learn the law during law school by suing, you know, the law school. Obviously I didn't do that, but it was a joke. I mean, it wasn't a joke like to be mean against men or to be mean against women. It was just like, hey, let's just try it and see what they do. It was more like just to see what they do, you know. But it wasn't sincere, right? So what you're saying, a lot of times, if people claim, you know, I'm a woman, but they're a man or vice versa, there's like a sincerity issue. You know, same thing with religion. Like if someone says, oh, I should be able to take, you know, Fridays off.
Oh, yeah.
You know, but if it's a sincere kind of, you know, because otherwise people could be lying, right?
Mm-hmm.
So, you know, I don't know.
Yeah.
I do know. I think it's going to gravitate toward that. But I think if somebody does it and they're not sincere, I think then the sport can reject that person. And then, you know, but proving someone is sincere is...
It's tough,
It's tough, yeah. When I was in college at UCLA, this is now, we're going 1995, I think it was. There was a professor, it was a great professor, Mobat, I think his last name was pronounced, right? He said, when he was talking about constitutional law, there's this issue of sincerity. Keep in mind, 1995. He would pick a girl in the class, right? And usually it would be a cute girl. And he just picks a cute girl. He's like, Monique, I love you. Am I being sincere? Right? And his point was, it's a subjective test. How can you prove it or not? Do you see what I mean?
Yes.
I don't know if a professor would do that today.
I know. Yeah. It's the way it's received nowadays is very, it's just kind of very risky, very dangerous territory.
Right. Which, and it's pretty good because, you know, you put someone in an awkward position when you're joking with them, say, I love you. Like, oh, it's crazy. You know, I don't know. So anyway, it wasn't until 1985 that the women had their first games, international games. My favorite World Cup, when I was I was a kid, it was in that 1986 World Cup. That was the Diego Maradona hand of God when he made the goal.
Yes.
Yeah. and supposedly hit it with his hand, and he had this like great run against, I think it was the British team when it, like he got the ball in the midfield and
Took it by himself.
Yeah, took it by himself all the way down. Yes. In fact, let's just play a clip of that right now. Okay. There it is. I could just visualize it, right?
There's Diego Maradona. Before HD, though, you couldn't. That's why you can't.
I
know. Tell.
I wish they could do an HD version of all of that, right? Yeah. The 1994, the Men's World Cup was here in the United States. Obviously, the men's team made a lot of money that team. And then they qualified for the World Cup only because they were the host team, which automatically get a qualification. Yes.
But they did well. They played
they
well.
They did okay, yeah. They beat Colombia, which was good but bad, but that poor guy got killed later.
It was
later.
An own goal. I don't know if you call that a win.
I know, but a win's a win, right? And now we get to, you know, some interesting things about the kind of the discrepancy here, you know, the men's team versus the women's team. Obviously, the men's historically, you know, obviously there's some years where the women will make more because the men didn't get qualified to the World Cup some years when the women did. Overall, though, obviously the men's team, they just draw more money because more people attend men's games. So per game, there's more of a draw, you know, for men's game. Ticket sales, you know, advertising money, all of that, right? Now, the United States Federation is a non-profit, okay, which I have another joke. Non-profits, like big non-profits, make a lot of freaking profit.
A lot of money.
Yeah, it's like, how does that work? You know, I have a for-profit business, and I wish I made as much money as these non-profits, right? Because and non-profits, every non-profit has to file taxes. The good part about it is that it's public information, you know? So when they file their taxes in a nonprofit, it's all public information. It's ordinarily, they post it on various websites. This entity, the United States Federation, in 2019, it was like 2019-2020 fiscal year, right? Their revenue was just under $140 million. That's huge.
Wow.
Right? Yes. Yeah. $140 million. Some of it, a very little of it was grants, because by then their revenue from ticket sales and advertising is like 90% of it, I think.
Okay.
Right? So $140 million. They paid their sporting director $750,000 a year. The CEO, $750,000 a year. Right?
Wow.
Exactly.
That's
non-profit.
Some good money. Yeah.
That is some good money, you know? One thing that was funny, their financial officer was getting $300,000 a year, you know, maybe it was like an extra bit just to say, hey, don't reduce our salary.
Yes, exactly.
You know, that year, one thing that was amazing is they paid to a law firm, the law firm of Latham and Watkins, $8 million,
$8 million
in 1 year. And then a couple of other things, they have cash on hand, you know, the balance sheets, you're a business, you know, so in their balance sheet, they have, like $140 million in cash or stocks, you know, things like that, you know, kind of cash on hand.
Yeah.
So they're
liquidate easy.
Yeah. They can liquidate easy. I mean, this is a very rich entity, you know, this nonprofit. I want to be in it. Let's start a nonprofit.
We should.
And that nonprofit, their goal, they just say to promote soccer. That's their charitable, you know, goal. It's to promote soccer.
This is their vision.
The vision, right? Okay. And now finally we, you know, this is the, so it's a very popular organization. You know, they get a lot of money from FIFA, the worldwide, you know, which is good. You know where the World Cup is this coming, this year?
Qatar, I believe.
Yes, yes. And that was corrupt.
It's messy.
Yeah, it was proved. And they just they agreed. Okay,
and
fine.
They still keep going, right? Yeah, no penalty.
We got kickbacks from Qatar. And the World Cup is still gonna be there. Like they didn't take it away from there. So this is, you know, all right, so we're dealing with this funny thing. Now what happened was about 7 years ago, okay, there were some of the soccer players started complaining, saying we're not getting equal pay to the men, right? So because there's the women's team and then there's the men's team.
Okay.
So there was this complaint that, you know, we're not getting equal pay, right? And then it took a while. They had to go to this one commission and just to get the right to sue them, you know. It's the employment law. There's like these before you file a lawsuit, in some cases, you have to try to go to this, you know, through administrative procedures or through this commission, blah, blah, blah. So yeah. It's a long time just before they were able to
go
file.
To mediation first.
Yeah, sometimes if there's a contract provision in there that says, uh-huh. you know, we have to go to mediation before we file a lawsuit, that could delay it, you know, things like that. And then it wasn't until March 8, 2019, they filed the lawsuit for alleging that the women were not getting equal pay. Uh-huh. March 8 is a holiday. It's the National Women's Day or
International Women's Day.
International Women's Day. That's what I hear. Sorry. Yeah. So they filed it on International Women's Day on March 8, 2019.
Way to plant the flag.
Way to plant the flag. I love it. Yes. I love it. They filed their lawsuit, and I remember reading the lawsuit. Back then, that was three years. They just settled 2 days ago. So that, right, 2019 was 3 years ago. March 2019, 3 years ago. And it took a couple years just to get that lawsuit, uh-huh. just to be allowed to be able
to file. The courts are a slow process sometimes.
Slow as a process, yes. And so they weren't able to file it until March 2019. Now, here's where it kind of gets weird, okay? The women, okay, so when you file a lawsuit, you can go, there's a statute of limitations how far you can go back. So they were able to go back to this, it was like 2014. Okay. So the kind of operative years are 2014 to 2019, okay, mm-hmm. around that. So the operative years is 2014 to 2019. Now, the women's national team. So the head, you know, the lawsuit is Alex Morgan. Okay, she's one of the best soccer players on the women team, right?
Yes.
Versus and all of the others versus United States Soccer Federation. So it's the title of the lawsuit is Morgan v. U.S. You know, Federal Soccer
or uh-huh.
Federation of Soccer, right? Okay. Now this is where it gets weird. This is the women's team made more money than the men's team. Like the women, the players made more money than the male players. This mm-hmm. is what a lot of people don't
see. That's what I like. Let's fight for equal pay.
Yeah. No, but here, you're saying like the men complained.
Is that what the lawsuit was about?
No. Oh, the lawsuit.
Okay.
So the women filed the lawsuit. Uh-huh. Even though everyone agrees, there's no dispute that during the time period, the women got more money. The female players made more money than the male players.
Uh-huh.
Okay. And so only lawyers can conjure up a way to, you know, when one team is making more money, then they file a lawsuit saying they're not getting paid as much, right? Now, let me kind of, this is where, you know, everything gets a little bit crazy. And the allegations are, you know, they're claiming discrimination under the Civil Rights Act of 1964. There's a federal Equal Pay Act. So they're saying that the men get more money than the women, right? Uh-huh. And where it gets dicey, it kind of goes like this. I'll give you some kind of, you know, and I'm rounding off numbers just to make it kind of easy, kind of examples. So let's say in a given year, right? Let's say both teams, they have a base salary uh-huh. of, you know, let's say $1 million each.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. And then let's say there's bonus structures for That's each right. team. Uh-huh. Okay. Bonus, like if you get to the World Cup, we'll pay extra this. If you win some games of the World Cup, we'll pay this. If you win friendlies, call friendlies are like not World Cup games, but like, okay. you know, off World Cup games or something, uh-huh. right? You know, we'll pay this, blah, 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 right? And then for those bonuses, you know, there was like a pay structure. Now, the bonus structure was a lot better for the men. Mm-hmm. So if the men win the World Cup, like, you know, it would be like $7 million. If the women win the World Cup, it's like $500,000, for example.
Okay.
You know, I mean, I'm rounding.
Big discrepancy.
You know, it's a huge discrepancy. Now, why the heck did the women get paid more is because, okay, so the base salary is $1 million. The women's team rocked everything, right? Yes. They are awesome. They won tournaments.
Number one in the world.
Yeah, by far, right? And so they got, let's say $1.5 million in bonuses. So their total pay is, let's say $2.5 million, right? Uh-huh. and then the men, let's say, only got $1 million bonus, like in one given year, for example. Uh-huh. So their total pay was $2 million, right? So the women made more money. Mm-hmm. You with me?
Yes.
Okay.
Well, trying to follow up.
So because so they're making more money. Now, the argument is, it goes like this. What they're saying is that they got about the same pay, you know, give or take, maybe it was a little bit more, but they got around the same pay for much better performance, you know, for, you know, and then they played more games, you know. I mean, it did work out. Even per game, they were getting a little more, you know, so and they played more games, right? But the claim goes like this. Had the men's team won as many games and won a World Cup and competed as good as the girls did, right? Then the men would have made like $70 million.
Wow, okay.
Do you see what I'm saying? Uh-huh. Whereas the women,
they only made that two.
It was, yeah, exactly, right? So they're saying that it was only, is it like by coincidence, not coincidence, but by chance, kind of, you know, and that the discrimination is that the bonus structures are so much better for the men. Mm-hmm. Do you see what I'm saying?
Yeah.
And that it's not fair, you know, the discrimination is that you're paying women the same amount for doing a much better job.
Well, you could flip it around too. Had the women not played as high level as they did, like if they played, you know, just as bad as the men did, not advanced,
right,
then they would have made only that $1 million.
Mm-hmm.
The men would have made the $2 million.
Exactly. Right. That's the whole point. Yeah. You know, so the whole point is that the discrimination was in the pay structure and the bonus structure.
Uh-huh.
Right. And then in terms of the lawsuit, okay, so they filed the lawsuit in federal court, okay, in California. And it's allowed to go in federal court. The jurisdiction is proper in the federal court because the Federal Civil Rights Act and the Federal Equal Pay Act. And so it goes to federal court. In jurisdiction terms, it's called a federal question, right?
Okay.
It's a federal issue. So they go to federal court, not the state court, right? And it took a while. It took over 2 years of litigation, and the court dismissed the you know, basically dismissed the majority of the claims. You know, they cut the girl's case. The judge, you know, cut the girl's case. Like the judge said, this is not improper discrimination, right? And ruled in favor of the soccer federation.
Okay,
all right. And the judge said, this is the reasoning in the trial court judge, all right, the federal judge. He said, well, the women did make more money. Like that was a, you know, whatever, they made more. This is what the judge is saying, like in this complicated opinion and order and blah, blah, blah. The women did make more money. And then the judge cited these the agreements, the collective bargaining agreements with the women's teams and the men's teams. And there was a few things. Okay, and a lot of people, you know, when I brought this issue up and I talked to people, they'll ask me, like, well, didn't the women agree to this? One of the things that the women's team said is, well, of course we agreed to it because we don't have a choice. Do you see what I'm saying? Like we agreed, but that's still, you know, it's kind of like the theory that, you know, if somebody agrees to work for less than minimum wage, you can't hire him for less than minimum wage, even if he's willing to do it. Do you see what I'm saying?
I see.
So if somebody agrees to take less money than they deserve, you know, for discriminatory purposes, they're saying that they could, that agreement doesn't nullify the discrimination.
I see.
Do you see what I'm saying?
Yeah.
The federal judge said no. Right, the federal judge didn't agree with that either. Basically saying, well, these are collective bargaining agreements, and they were well fought out, and you know, and he said something. You know, the women, they kind of wanted less bonuses and higher kind of guaranteed salaries.
Uh-huh. You know, here under also some benefits like health.
Yes, yeah.
Healthcare.
Something. Yeah, exactly. Mm-hmm. So they were going for like kind of those guarantees more than the bonuses, whereas the men were willing to get less guarantees and more bonuses. If that, mm-hmm. Do you see what I'm saying? So that was another thing the judge like cited. Okay. So the judge makes that order in May 2021.
Uh-huh.
Right. And then, the girls lost. Now, that was 8 months ago or so.
Uh-huh.
The women then filed an appeal.
Okay.
All right. And in their appeal, they said this was bogus. You know, the judge screwed up. That we are entitled, you know, to equal bonuses, right? Mm-hmm. The collective bargaining agreement doesn't kill our lawsuit. So they filed that appeal in the Ninth Circuit Court of Appeal. The defendants, opposed the appeal. Yeah, the U.S. Soccer opposed the appeal. And right now, that is pending, you know, before the Ninth Circuit. Now, let me tell you a little bit about appellate law in the Ninth Circuit. You could file an appeal, and then it takes like almost a year for the briefs to go, you know, like uh-huh. the scheduling. And then the Ninth Circuit was going to have a panel make a decision. And that decision could take a month. It could take a year, or it could take 2 years. Like, who the heck knows? And you can't call the judges and say, hey, what's up with our case? You know, you can't. It could take forever. So during that time, they settled, you know, and then that was just a couple days ago.
I see. So, yeah. So they settled. They didn't wait for that to go along and to come with a decision.
Exactly. Okay. Right. I mean, I don't know. What do you think the court? I think the court would have ruled in favor of pause for effect. I think the court would have ruled in favor of shucks. It's hard to predict. That's why there's a settlement.
Yeah.
The women were asking for $64 million. That's how much they would have made during that time if their bonus structure was the same.
Okay.
You know, I don't know. I think, you know, this is what lawyers say. Yeah. Right. This is lawyers. This is a typical lawyer response. I think the Soccer Federation has a good argument, and I think most likely they would prevail because, you know, this was a collectively bargained agreement, and the women opted for less bonuses and more salary, you know, and I think that, you know, the fact that they got paid more, you know, I think the court would have ruled in that favor. You know, but the women could have won too.
Yeah. So they set up the argument and then they just.
Yeah, okay. That's a typical lawyer response.
So I have a lawyer question here.
Uh-huh.
So the settlement was $24 million that goes to the
women. The players that filed the lawsuit. Yes.
This process was about, what, two years and 8 months? Mm-hmm. Oh, I got it.
Oh, it's okay. Okay.
2 years and 8 months or so.
Yeah.
And all this time, you got lawyers and hours being spent. How much was spent on like lawyer fees and stuff?
Millions. It's unbelievable because the issue seems kind of simple,
uh-huh.
right? It's the pay was more because they did way better, uh-huh. right? Yeah. And the bonus structures were way different, right? And so I could see. I mean, there was discrimination because the bonus structures are way better for the men. Yeah. Now this is the. I bet you, okay, this is another kind of funny thing I thought of. I wonder if the men's team, after this haul comes down, like if they do get equal pay in the future, right? The men's team file a lawsuit saying, wait a minute, we brought in more money. You know, if they make more money, you know, 1 year they kind of play the same or something. And it just so happens if they make it to the World Cup, the men's World Cup, they get more money from the World Cup.
Uh-huh.
You know, if they win a men's World Cup, it's like 10 times more money almost than if the women win. If 1 year the men do that and the women do that and then they get the same pay, for example, the men could file a lawsuit saying, well, if you judge performance on revenue that was brought in, we performed way better. You know?
Yeah,
it's like
it's a much bigger market. The men's game, yeah. It's just been going on. You know, like you said, it's been not around for a lot longer. The competition, there's a lot more teams. I think I want to say that there's 32 teams in the men's World Cup and 24 for the women's.
Oh, that's right. They field more teams.
So they're gonna play a little bit. You know, at least one more game.
Right.
They were to advance, but I guess.
I think what would be fair and what the women's team kind of points out is because this is one employer, it's kind of like, let's have a structure where Man, it's going to be tough. Maybe it'll be something like we'll have a structure where wherever revenue we receive, then the same percentage goes to both teams.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah.
But gosh, that could present a problem because if other men's teams from other countries are getting paid way more, do you see what I'm saying? Because their laws are probably a little different, maybe, right? And so then if the U.S. team says, well, how the heck are we going to compete? We have to pay these guys this much more. You know what I'm saying? Like, it could then make the men's team really bad and the women's team really good, you know? So it's going to be it's hard. It's hard when it comes down to this. And that's why lawyers make a living and judges taking years to decide this, which seems like something that should have been decided, you know, fairly quickly. You know, I think, do you think there was some PR reasons for settling that lawsuit as opposed to they were afraid of the appellate court decision?
Yeah, I mean, I think that plays into the, you know, into what's going on. I think the court of public opinion and just the view on equal pay, just equality. I think also it kind of, I feel like it probably prohibits other things from going on within U.S. soccer. And so I think it probably is, it's good for both sides to say, hey, let's get this resolved in a way that we can agree, and then let's move on forward.
Let's move on to soccer. Let's finally win some games, guys.
what I understand, too, I believe that there's a new collective bargaining agreement coming up in the next couple months. And so they're going to have, that's an opportunity to hopefully revamp that and eliminate some of those gaps that are huge right now.
Right. And then some sort of way to move forward that's kind of more equal for everyone. Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, let's have a sequel to this in 2 years.
That's right.
This,
see how things are going.
Because one of the things in the settlement was that, you know, in addition to the $24 million, they said, okay, moving forward, we'll try to make a more fair system, which is beautiful for lawyers because know that that's arguable. Well, look, before we go, I always end this. I tell people, and it works. I mean, you know, I want people to reach out to me. Sometimes I could save years of litigation with kind of a 20-minute talk or whatever. So give me a call, run it by my lawyer, call me anytime. My cell phone number, 619-672-1741. And usually at this time for the guest speaker, they usually give us their social security number. Credit card number, please. All right. Thank you so much, OC.
Hey, thank you so much for having me. It's great.
All right, my friend. We'll see you next week.